Well, we did get through the first 13 verses of chapter 3, which means we start at verse 14. That's profound, isn't it? And as a reminder, Jesus is in a conversation with this man, Nicodemus. Nicodemus, a very brilliant man, a respected man, an important, powerful man. We talked a lot about Nicodemus's background last week, so I won't repeat it all, but there was a conversation going on. Nicodemus was saying some things, Jesus going back and forth. Now Jesus is just speaking to him. And it's interesting, if you will note, that God's word does not record any further responses from Nicodemus here, as Jesus just continues to lay out what he's been saying, starting in verse 10. Again, we looked at a few verses last week. And then the teaching is going to end at verse 21, and we don't read of Nicodemus talking. Now, maybe he did, but again, it's just another example how in God's word, God wants us to know these things. He did want us to know a few of the things that Nicodemus asked, the puzzlement, the confusion, even the maybe frustration that was coming in his questions. But now, doesn't matter, because our Lord is laying it down right here. So, we are at verse 14, and here's what we read. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Now, Nicodemus, being who he was, would certainly understand the reference instantly that Jesus is giving. Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. But I think it's good for us on a Wednesday night to take a moment and turn to Numbers chapter 21. The Old Testament book of Numbers, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers chapter 21, where we read of the event as it took place in history. It's when the people of Israel were there in the wilderness before they entered the promised land, as you might guess from the reference in the book of Numbers. Moses is their leader, of course. And in Numbers chapter 21, we read verse 4, they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. Numbers 21, verse 4. And the soul of the people became very discouraged on the way. Isn't it interesting? You know, sometimes the Bible records some pretty heavy sins. Murder, adultery, you know. But it's fascinating the problems that happen with things like discouragement. Which we think, oh, that's not that big a deal. I mean, everyone gets discouraged, don't they? But how you deal with discouragement as a child of God, as the people of God. Israel didn't deal with discouragement very well. So they're very discouraged on the way. And what happens? Verse 5, the people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and our soul loathes this worthless bread. Now, boy, they could not be wrong on more counts in one verse, I think, than if they had tried. They're speaking against both God and Moses. Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? How quickly they forget what was going on in Egypt. Remember, they were slaves in Egypt under terrible taskmasters that were just burdening them tremendously. They were crying out to God, God, deliver us from this burden. Well, God delivered them. And now they're complaining to God, saying, we should be back in Egypt. And then, of course, there is no food and no water. Well, that's just a flat-out lie. It's a flat-out lie. God miraculously provided both food and water for them. They wouldn't be alive if he hadn't. And that's the thing, isn't it, though? The Bible promises God providing our needs. We might have some wants, even some desires here and there. No necessary promise for all those. You know, God will give you everything your heart desires. No, can't say that. I don't think we want everything our heart desires. Bible says our heart is desperately wicked. You know, we might desire some things that God says, that's no good for you. And so is it true that they had no food, no water? Of course not. That's false. It's a false claim. But at the same time, I'm sure it was a pretty monotonous sort of existence, having the same thing every day to eat, the manna that God provided in the wilderness. They even reference it. We've got no food. Oh, and we hate the food that we have. Well, wait a minute. Which is it, right? You know? So we're getting tired of this. Our soul loathes this. And it's just an all-around horrible criticism. But notice, again, it was rooted in their discouragement. When people are discouraged, they say crazy things sometimes. Now, we have an opportunity to recognize that, just as an aside, not really the main focus of the passage, but, you know, we don't have to necessarily, on our end, get overly offended or any of that when someone who is clearly discouraged says something that's kind of out there. And especially in times of great grief and difficulty, sometimes people will say some things, and they might even say some things about God. And, you know, there's a time and a place to, you know, correct somebody's theology, if you know what I mean. The Bible talks about weep with those who weep, right? You know, you can have joy with those who are having joy. That's easy to do, right? Celebrate with someone, they have good news. Say, all right, that's great, I'm happy for you. But to just sit there and weep with those who weep, just, you know, be with them. There's something that is a ministry of presence. I'm not talking about gifts. I'm talking about presence, being present, just being there. You think, but I got to say something. I got to, you know, how, as if we could pick up one Bible verse or one, you know, pithy little comment that's somehow what? Going to remove all their grief, remove all their sorrow, remove all their frustration, whatever it is that they're going through. We're not that smart. And again, time and a place. And so there is a place for that ministry of presence. Now, in this case, though, these people, Israel, I'm talking about, this is not like their first mistake with God. And so they have been complaining. They have been criticizing. And they've committed some other greater sins as well, like we talked about, fornication, idolatry, and so forth. And so God's going to bring a judgment. Now, why does God bring judgment? Well, he is trying to teach a lesson. We talk about discipline. God disciplines. He disciplines those he loves. Discipline always has the goal of teaching. It's even in the word, discipline, disciple, right? The idea is to teach. Now, verse 6, the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people. Many of the people of Israel died. And the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned." Ah, you see? It led to repentance. "We've sinned. We've spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people. Now, then this is where it gets interesting, and this is what Jesus is referring to, because the Lord could have said, all right, and snakes go away, right? The Lord said to Moses, "Make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live." So Moses made a bronze serpent and put it on a pole, and so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. Now that is fascinating. So you gotta go construct this thing, Moses, set it up in the camp. And again, that will be the means for their salvation, physical salvation, their healing, if they get bit by a snake. Now, obviously, the pole didn't save anybody. God saved them, but this was the method he used. And it basically, I think, in the moment was key, because, all right, are you going to obey God or not? Because if they did, they were healed. But of course, as Jesus is pointing out, it's also going to lead to a lesson, an object lesson, a symbolism for later on. But for the moment, now just think about it. Just kind of place yourself there. among the people of Israel, and maybe your friend over here just got bit by one of those snakes. And you tell him, look to the pole. And the guy's, you know, hurting, and he says, oh, that's ridiculous. That's stupid. I'm not going to do that. So, no, man, look to the pole. I mean, other people are doing it. They're getting healed. This is how you get healed. God told Moses to put this pole up, and you got the serpent on the pole. Look there. God will heal you if you just, that's dumb. I'm not going to do it. That makes no sense to me. At some point, you're going to tell your friend, well, then I guess you're just going to die. Because this is the means for your earthly salvation here. This is how you're going to be healed from that snake bite. Are you going to do what God says or not? Now, we come to Jesus, of course. We go back to John chapter 3, if you'd like, but I want you to actually see the events. And you see that Jesus is actually speaking very literally here. Go back again, John chapter 3, where we were, as Moses lifted up the serpent. Now, notice that. Now, Moses, because, again, you construct this serpent and somehow attach it to this pole, and then what? The pole with the serpent on it, of course, is lifted up in the camp. So, as he has lifted up the serpent, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. Now, sometimes in our worship, and this is okay, I'm not saying this is wrong, but sometimes in our worship, when we talk about lifting up the Lord, we're talking about exalting him, exalting his name. Let's lift up the Lord together in song. Nothing wrong with that. But just recognize, you know, context is everything. And here, the idea of lifted up is speaking of the cross, which, just like this serpent on the pole, truly, Jesus was nailed to the cross, and what? He was lifted up. And that's what crucifixion was, as he hung on that cross. Now, this is John chapter 3. Jesus knows his destiny. Jesus knows his reason, what he's there for. He says that he must be lifted up. And whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. Wasn't it true with Moses and the serpent, the bronze serpent? Whoever believes will not perish. Earthly life. You won't perish. You won't die of the snake bite. Now Jesus is bringing it to the spiritual, to the higher power here, the higher degree, excuse me, will have eternal life. But you must believe. You know, the interesting thing about talking about Jesus being exalted, the reason we exalt his name in worship is because he was lifted up, literally, at the cross. So we lift up his name in worship in the sense of exalting because he was literally lifted up at his crucifixion. So he's talking to Nicodemus, and he's again, saying, last week we looked at it, you have to have a spiritual birth. And Nicodemus was confused and trying to figure that out. And Jesus is saying, you know, hey, if I'm teaching you these things, how come you don't know this stuff? And then he says, and no one's gone to heaven. And again, I'm not going to review everything from last week. But now all of a sudden, this is obviously the connection to the spiritual birth, isn't it? Because it makes no sense for him to start talking about the cross now. But that's why, because this is how the spiritual birth takes place. To look to the Son of Man, lifted up there at the cross, and believe. Now, of course, there's more to it than that. In fact, that cross does not have Jesus still hanging on it. That is one of my big criticisms of the crucifix, where Jesus is hanging on the cross. I have no problem with showing a cross. We've got one right on the building, don't we? But we don't have Jesus hanging from it because he was taken off that cross after he died. The sacrifice was made on the cross. He was taken off. He was buried. And then he got out of the grave. And the tomb is empty. We ought to have a big open grave on the building too, except it would be a big hole and it wouldn't make sense. But that's what we remember. But Jesus isn't getting into the whole gospel here, but The cross is where the sacrifice is going to be. This is where salvation takes place. And now we get into not just probably the most famous verse in the entire Bible, but really a summary of the entire Bible. I mean, you know, we've been talking about how if someone doesn't know anything about anything, that the Bible or God or whatever, say, hey, read the Gospel of John. It's a good place to start. Okay. What if you want to narrow it down even further? What if you've got like 5 minutes to talk to somebody? You don't have time to go through a whole book of the Bible or whatever. And you really, in my opinion, can't find a better place in the Bible than these last six verses or so here that we're reading tonight. I say last, I'm talking about from verse 16 to when Jesus stopped speaking in verse 21. Because it really does lay it out. And you know, when we think about the Bible, we think about the story of the Bible. I don't mean story in the sense of a fairy tale, obviously. I just mean the account, the record, the history. We have the creation in the first two chapters of Genesis, and then boom, what happens in chapter 3? We've got sin entering the world. And the very first promise of God to send a Savior right there, Genesis chapter 3. And that promise is going to be continued on and reaffirmed and given more details and so forth. And you go through the entire Bible. It is a book about our salvation. Why so much focus on Israel? Oh, because for God to bring a Savior in, this guy has to be associated with the people, and so we're going to make a nation. We're going to pick a godly man like Abraham. We're going to make a great nation of him. And you know, so you have the story as it unfolds all the way through in the Old Testament. And so, this is the key to the whole Bible. It really is. I don't think it's an exaggeration. You know, after Jesus' resurrection, when he was walking with the two guys from Emmaus, on the road to Emmaus, excuse me, and they didn't know who he was, but they knew about the tremendous events that had happened in Jerusalem. Like, oh, didn't you hear about this guy, Jesus? We thought, you know. And it says that he began right there at the beginning, and he went through the entire Old Testament with them, basically. And showed all the things about himself. In the New Testament, what do we see Peter and Paul and these others? We see them reasoning with people from the Scriptures. The New Testament wasn't even written yet. They were going to the Old Testament. Jesus in the Old Testament. He's in every book. He's just all over the place. And then we have the Gospels, of course, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John tell us his life. And of course, the focus, as we've said before, are on what? The events around the cross and the resurrection. Yes, 3.5 years of earthly ministry, not to mention all the years of just being an adult and walking around. But the focus is the cross and the resurrection and the events around that week. And then we have the book of Acts with those early Christians taking that message to the whole world, just as Jesus instructed them. We've got the epistles that tell us who have received the message, believed it, and because God doesn't instantly take us to heaven at that moment, we live down here in this fallen world, but now we've had the spiritual birth that Jesus is talking about, tell us how we are to live in light of our new relationship with God, with our sins forgiven. The whole Bible is focused on this. And yet, like I say, summarized in just a few verses here. Verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Whoever believes in him, but notice, he says that after saying that this one would have to be lifted up on the cross, you see. So, oh, I believe in Jesus. Yeah, he's a great guy, you know. I mean, we ought to follow his teachings more. It'd be a better world. That's not what he's talking about. God so loved the world that he gave. Love is the motivation, isn't it? Right here in this verse. And the thing about love, you know, in the Bible we have a chapter in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 13, that is commonly called the love chapter of the Bible because it starts talking about love. love suffers long and is kind, and the importance of love. So there's a lot about love in 1 Corinthians 13. And I don't want to take a side study on love, but what you will find if you go read that chapter tonight or tomorrow, whatever, is you will see that love shows itself with action. See, love is kind. In other words, love is not just some fuzzy emotion that we can't really quite put our finger on it. You know, we just get butterflies in the stomach or whatever, to, you know. No, love shows itself in action. And God showed his love to the world by action, specifically giving his only begotten Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I often say that the only place you will ever see in the Bible, the only way, I should say, not place, because there's several places in the Bible, the only time, the only way you will see God showing his love to the world, those verses will always point you to the cross, just like this one does right here. Whenever you see God loving people, the cross is always associated in that verse. Herein is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and gave his son for us. You see, it's always that connection. Some people say, how do I know that God loves me? I don't think God loves me. I've had a terrible life. I had from the time I was a child, you know, my parents were horrible to me. I don't doubt that, but that's not the standard. Our earthly existence is not the standard to prove whether or not God loves us. If we ever doubt God's love, we look to the cross, and then the doubts have to go. Because if that's not good enough for somebody, you're like the guy who got bit by the snake in the wilderness in Moses' day. I'm not going to do that. Well, then I got nothing else for you. But God does love us. He loves us beyond what we could possibly imagine. Because can you imagine giving your only begotten child to a bunch of sinners, most of whom could care less about the sacrifice that you are offering? Because that's the reality of Christ's sacrifice. God so loved, notice, the world. Now, you know, a Jew like Nicodemus could relate to the idea, you know, God so loved Israel, you know, because there was that mindset. But the world? You mean that pagan, filthy, Gentile, vile world? All those God loves them too? That was kind of a shock. Took him a while to kind of get with the program on that. But yes, God loves the entire world. And that's so important to remember, because it also speaks to the fact that Jesus' death is sufficient for the sins of the whole world. Now, I spoke about how that can be, you know, how one individual can die for the sins of the world. We talked about how Adam and his sin affected the whole world. We talk about how Jesus is our creator, can save the whole world. It's sufficient. And some people are bothered by that because they think, well, you know, how could Jesus die for people who end up in hell? But that's just the point. The people have to believe in him to not perish and receive the gift of everlasting life. But the sacrifice is sufficient. There's a profound verse. I'll just read it. I don't take the time to look it up. But if you are curious of the reference, it's in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10. Paul writes, "For to this end we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those who believe." See, there is a sense that he is the Savior of all, because the cross is sufficient for all. But the cross is only efficient for those who believe, who trust him. And the Bible, by the way, teaches that very clearly. And I don't want to get into the passages to develop that. And there's some fun little Greek prepositions that are used by God. One that speaks to the sufficiency, one that speaks to the efficiency. But this is the teaching of the Bible. God did love the whole world. That love shows itself in action. Gave his only begotten son, and whoever, the invitation is open. Whoever wants to, and that's also something we see repeated over and over in the Bible. Whosoever will, let him come. That's why we're told to share the gospel with every creature. And now, it's with that person and God. Now, but as important and well-known as verse 16 is, I believe that we should not say verse 16 without also saying verse 17. I mean, we probably should say we should say all these verses, but let's be realistic. Okay, just try to include verse 17 when you quote verse 16. Because what does verse 17 say? For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. You see, the moment you start speaking about being saved, not perishing, that implies that there's something to be saved from. Right? Just like the people who were bit by the snakes, they needed to be saved from the poisonous snake bites. So humanity, the world, the whole world needs to be saved. Because not only are we lost, but we are on that way to condemnation and perishing and judgment. You know, it's not like the world was somehow morally neutral and God sent Jesus and wanted to see, you know, oh, all right, this is how we're going to pick teams, right? Whoever wants to join the Christian side, they'll get heaven, and everyone who doesn't want to, they'll go to hell. You'd be surprised at how many people in the world kind of think along those lines, don't they? That's when you start hearing, well, what's the difference between all the different religions? And why should the Christian? Because this is where the sacrifice, this is where the shedding of blood for the remissions of sins took place. And of course, it's impossible for the blood of bulls and calves and goats to put away human sin. Jesus shed his own precious blood. He took on a body. He became a man in order to die so that that sacrifice could be made and that sacrifice accepted in full as seen in the glorious resurrection. So he didn't come in order to create some sort of a standard whereby God could condemn people. Oh, you didn't want to believe in Jesus? All right, well then you're going to hell. No, we're already on the road to hell. See, we're already facing that judgment. But that's why I say verse 17 goes so well with verse 16 as a reminder. God did not send his son. The Father did not send Jesus into the world to condemn the world. No, because the world's already condemned, and that's where we're going in the next couple of verses. But rather that the world through him might be saved. Might be saved. Because again, sadly, many will not come. But that's not God's fault. And it doesn't speak to somehow Jesus' sacrifice being insufficient in any way. Far from it. Now, how wonderful this is to read for everyone, hopefully, in the room tonight. Verse 18. He who believes in him is not condemned. Amen. I mean, that, boom. Do you see a bunch of qualifiers there? He who believes in him is not condemned. Boom. As long as you go to church, as long as you do the, you believe in him, you're not condemned. Now, let me show the flip side before we talk about that glorious truth for all of us. Here's the flip side. But he who does not believe is condemned already because he's not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So this is what I was talking about. We all stand in a place of condemnation because of our sins. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And that is such an important truth, and it really shouldn't take a lot of convincing if we're honest with ourselves. In fact, most people, even jokingly, say, well, nobody's perfect. That's right. But God is, and that's what he expects. That's his standard. And so we're all in a guilty state before God. And God is holy. He's righteous. Can you imagine being in some terrible, brutal dictatorship of a country and you broke a law? So, well, it wasn't that big a deal, was it? I mean, it was a... And you got to face the prison system, and they might just throw you in prison for 20 years, throw away the key. They don't have the same sort of judicial, constitutional protections and so forth. You know, I have a right to a lawyer and a phone call. Yeah, yeah, right, pal. You'd be lucky if we throw you some moldy bread. You can rot in here as far as we care. You know, just think about that. Now, I'm not saying God is a brutal dictator. Far from it. But what I'm showing is that God is holy. He's perfect. He's righteous. And the idea of like, well, it was just a few sins. They weren't that big a deal, were they? Is so misguided. It's like saying, well, yeah, you know, I just broke a few laws there, you know, in this horrible country of our imagination here. You know, come on, judge. Not that big a deal, is it? We're condemned already unless we believe. But notice, he who believes in him is not condemned. Now, let's talk about this for a minute because, you know, I'm speaking to believers here. You know, I look around the room. I see who's here. We have a problem with condemnation because we're often condemning ourselves. The world certainly condemns us. The devil condemns you, whispers in your ear all sorts of lies and nasty things, doesn't he? Condemnation is a big deal because condemnation can really just bring you down. You feel like you're worthless. You feel like you're not, you know, worthy. I shouldn't even go to church, you know, after what I've done. The devil's like, yeah, that's right, don't go. How can I pray? I got to clean up my act. Like the devil's like, yeah, try to clean up your act in your own strength. Don't pray. Don't rely on God. Yeah, that'll work. And what happens is that's how Christians begin to spiral down the drain. And we've seen it happen to a lot of people over the years, haven't we? It's like, I haven't seen that guy in church for months. What's been going on? Like, oh, didn't you hear? He's back out. And, you know, and it breaks your heart. And again, at any moment, at any time, God is there. And yet, that condemnation. And I think that's why God emphasizes that there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans chapter 8. No condemnation. What did we just read here? Jesus' own words. He who believes in him is not condemned. See, we might condemn ourselves. The devil condemns us. The world condemns us. Who's left out of that? God. God does not condemn us. Now, there is something, though, that God will do to his children, and we all know this feeling, I'm sure, too, and that's called conviction. Conviction's different from condemnation. First of all, conviction comes from God, so it's obviously a good thing, because anything that comes from God's good. And conviction comes from God in order to get us to stop doing something we shouldn't be doing. God says, you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't have said that. You need to apologize to that person. You need to make amends. You need to, you know, need to go back and, you know, help out or whatever, right? Conviction. You get struck. Now, God's trying to encourage us through conviction to do the right thing. And sometimes as Christians, we just know we feel lousy, you know? Hey, I'm not interested in a bunch of semantics and dictionary definitions, Pastor. I just know I feel terrible. I don't know if it's condemnation or conviction. What's the difference? Well, the difference is everything, like I said. And it's not just dictionary terminology here. Because here's the key. Condemnation, as I said a moment ago, doesn't come from God, and yet what condemnation will do is drive you away from God, which is no good. Condemnation drives you away from God. I gave those examples. Yeah, don't go to church this weekend. Don't pray tonight. Conviction, true conviction, comes from God, comes from His Spirit within you as a child of God. And conviction will drive you to God, not away from God. See, conviction is where you say, oh, I need to pray right now. I need to just soak myself in God's word. I'm not going out tonight, guys. I'm going to just stay home and read the Bible and pray because I got to get right. I've just been doing some bad things. And you see, conviction will drive you to God, and that's the purpose, and that's what God wants. And yes, conviction doesn't feel very good. Condemnation doesn't feel very good. That's what I mean. People, I just feel terrible. Yeah, but ask yourself, are you being driven towards God, His word, prayer, fellowship with His people? Can't wait to, you know, is there a church service open on Friday night, you know, Saturday, you know? I just want to be with God's people and sing God's praises and hear His word taught and so forth. That's conviction. Condemnation has no place in our life, and it does not come from God. He who believes in Him is not condemned. Highlight that, you know, print it in large font and stick it on your refrigerator or whatever you got to do to get that into your head, child of God. Now, as we said, we stand in condemnation if we don't believe in the only begotten Son of God. And so let's look at verse 19 to finish this up. This is the condemnation. Again, you're condemned already because you haven't believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Okay? This is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world. Now, Jesus is referring to Himself, obviously. And elsewhere in John, He's very clear. I am the light of the world. The light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. Wow. Verse 20, for everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light lest his deeds should be exposed. Practicing evil, that is deliberately in God's word, and the Greek shows this, that is a very indefinite idea, and the idea is in a plural. So practicing evil, in other words, throw everything you want under that umbrella, right? You are just doing evil works in God's sight. Like I said, some guy's evil works might be different than another guy's evil works. And some guy might think, well, my evil works aren't that bad. But this is how you are living. You are living in ways that God does not approve. And by the way, those can be very subtle. Again, we think of just the big sins. What about the guy, though, who's working 16, 17 hours a day, 7 days a week? Because he's just trying to climb the corporate ladder and trying to be, you know, and doing all this. Not because, hey, I got to work 2-3 jobs because I can't feed my family on just one. But no, this guy's got plenty. His needs are met. He just wants more. Maybe he wants status. Maybe he wants the power. Maybe he wants the promotion. Yeah, his kids never see him, but that's all right because I can afford the best schools and the, you know, the best toys and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, God gets alone with that guy and says, you know what? You're practicing evil. If you're living in a way that goes against what God's will for you is, you're practicing evil. That's the issue there. And you see, those who are living that way hate the light. The light is Jesus. They don't come to the light. You talk to some of those people who are living that way. Again, they may be, you know, upstanding model citizens in a society, or however you want to describe it, find out how interested they are in the things of Jesus. I've met a lot of very successful, rich, you know, well-liked people over the years, especially my business career back in the day. And boy, some of those people, I mean, they just would shut down and could care less about anything having to do with the Lord and talking about Him. And that's just foolishness. That's just, you know, for either a bunch of ignorant hicks or, you know, a bunch of, you know, prisoners or drug addicts or, oh, great, they found Jesus, you know, but not guys like me, just normal people, and come on. Because they don't want to go to the light. Why, again? Lest the deeds be exposed. See, that's the beautiful thing about light, isn't it? Have you ever tried and, like, really wanted to clean something perfectly, right? I mean, I want to clean this. I mean, not, you know, sometimes you say, yeah, I got to clean. Okay. No, I really want to clean this, and it's a difficult thing. What are you going to do? You're going to have some bright light to really make sure I'm getting every little spot. That's what light does. It exposes the dirt. It exposes what you are trying to get rid of, what you're trying to clean up. That's what light does. Think about a surgeon. How bright are those surgery rooms, right? I mean, it's a disaster when the power goes off. I know they got generators or whatever like that, but I mean, those surgeons, they want the brightest because they're trying to find that little tumor or whatever it is. And, you know, they say, well, we got most of the tumor. No, we got to try to get every little bit. Give me some bright light. I want to make sure I don't miss any of it. That's what light does. Light exposes, and Jesus exposes. And that is a very uncomfortable thing for anyone who doesn't want to be exposed. Flip the illustration over and just think about the darkness. How often do people do things in a way that, like, I don't want people to see me? I'm going to make sure all my curtains are closed, right? If I'm doing something in the house that I really shouldn't be doing. If I go out and I'm going to do something outside that I really shouldn't be doing, I might wait and go to another town. No one knows me there. All right? Don't have to run the risk of embarrassment. When I buy that stuff at the store that I don't want people to know I'm buying, I make sure I drive, you know, 20 miles somewhere to, you know, a store where no one will know me. All the things that people will do so that their evil works are not exposed. And that's not even exposure by God. I mean, that's just, I don't want, you know, my neighbor or someone that I went to school with or something to catch me. Someone I work with. How much more when we're talking about the searing, searching light of God who reveals every little speck. So, why don't people go to Jesus? Here's your answer. Here's the answer. If I go to Jesus, then I don't like the idea of what he might say to me about my life. He might ask me to give up some things. He might ask me to start doing some stuff I don't want to do. And stop doing some stuff I want to keep doing. Do you notice there's nothing in there about, I'm just not intellectually persuaded enough that Jesus truly is the Son of God and the Savior of the world? You know, there's nothing about your intellect here, is there? As to why people don't come to Christ? Because a lot of people think there is. A lot of people say, oh, I just can't buy into that. That's not scientific. That's not, you know, all that kind of stuff. That's not true. Now, we have a word in our language, and I used to use this word quite a lot before I became a believer in Jesus Christ, which, as you most of you know, was not till I was 25. So, I mean, I went through high school, went through college, my early 20s. And especially in college, you know, you run into a lot of different people. You make friends with a lot of different people in different settings, your classmates, your, you know, dorm mates or whatever, guys you play sports with and stuff. And some of those people are, of course, Christians. And they might ask you, like, Christian, hey, you know, do you know the Lord? You want to go to church? I didn't want anything to do with that. But at the same time, I wasn't really looking to be insulting to people. They're my friends. So there's that word that you use. That word is agnostic. Well, you know I'm an agnostic. Because an agnostic, it sounds so intellectual in its way. And of course, like I say, especially in a setting like in college, which I'm talking about here, you know, my friends, well, you know, I'm an agnostic. Because if you say you're an atheist, I mean, that's a real slap in the face to someone who has faith, right? Well, I'm an atheist. And plus, you know, the Bible says the fool says in heart there's no God. You know, I wasn't a fool. I mean, I guess I was in a lot of ways. But I mean, the idea, I mean, atheism takes more faith than belief. I mean, you really believe that we're just here, you know, randomly out of nothing, we're just going to die and life has no meaning and purpose. If you really think through atheism, intellectually honest with yourself, boy, talk about a dead end. And talk about something improved. How can you prove there is no God? I mean, it's just ridiculous. So atheism is just, it's really the sign of a really hardened heart towards the things of God. Because there are atheists out there that are, you know, cause a lot of trouble. But no, an agnostic, you see, we can still be friends. I'm just not interested in anything you have to tell me about Jesus, and this will shut you up, but, you know, I'm an agnostic. I'm just checking it out. But it's ridiculous because if an agnostic supposedly is the person who says, I can't know whether there is a God or not, and therefore I don't take a side or choose a position. Now, is that true, though? Because the Bible tells us over and over again that we can know, that if we seek, we will find. And ultimately, that ended up being my testimony, showing that God has an ironic sense of humor. After calling myself an agnostic for a long time, I actually began to seek if there is truth, absolute truth. Because, you know, if you don't know something, if you don't know a fact, you go look it up, don't you? If you care enough, right? Who won the Academy Award last year? Oh, I forgot. You know, that. What was the best picture? What'd they vote for? Now, if you care, you'll just go look it up, and then you'll get your answer. Most of the time when I say that, I don't really care, I'm not going to bother. The point is, if you really care about your soul, you can find the truth. God will show you. Guaranteed 100%. But the reality is, a lot of people are like, yeah, I don't know, I wonder if God exists or not. Oh, well, let's go do something else. And how quickly forgotten. That was my desire back then in saying I was an agnostic. Like, can we change the subject? And so it was with much humor that after I became a believer, I found out that agnostic actually comes from a word, you go back enough in the origins, it means an ignoramus. It's quite fitting, isn't it? All those times I thought I was so intellectual, you know, I'm an agnostic. I'm an ignoramus. Yes. But once more, why? Why was I not interested? Why? Because I was living my life in a way that I knew was not a God-honoring way. And I knew enough about Christianity, I knew enough about my Christian friends that they didn't speak like I spoke, and they didn't live like I lived, and they weren't motivated by the things I was motivating, and their goals on a Friday night or a Saturday night were not what mine were. I knew that. And I knew there could be no reconciliation with the life that not only was I living, but I wanted to live, you see. I wanted to. Now, you asked me back then, are you practicing evil? I would have said, no, I'm not, you know, like, I'm not going out and, you know, hurting people, you know, and in my mind, I probably did hurt some people and their emotions or whatever, but I mean, I'm not like out manslaughter and murdering and pillaging and all that kind of stuff. But in God's sight, what a different perspective. Well, I didn't want anything to do with the light. No, and that's why I didn't want anything to do with Jesus. Now, fortunately, and by the way, that was all of you in verse 20 at some point in your life, till you were born again. Remember, the larger context, which we looked at last week, the spiritual birth, being born again. See how it's tied in, right? But then look at verse 21 as we close. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen, that they've been done in God. Wow. Now, this is what hits home to us, and this is what I want to leave us with. He who does the truth, singular, definite. Isn't that fascinating? Before, it was just indefinite, multiple acts that we were just going to call evil, that you practice, you live. That's how you run your life. But now it's the truth, singular, definite, the is in there. What is doing the truth? Is it about your good works and living? No, it's about believing in Jesus. That's the whole focus right here, believing in the Son of God. That's doing the truth. By the way, who called himself the way, the truth, and the life? See, so that's what we're focused on. He who does the truth. Give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Be born again. Have the spiritual birth, Nicodemus. Come to the light. And in doing so, and being born again, and having that spiritual birth, then what are we going to want to do? We're going to want to live our lives now in a way that pleases God, aren't we? Not in order to get saved, because we know that our good works do not save us. Only Jesus can save us. And our good works don't somehow keep us saved or anything like that. No, no, no. Because there's no condemnation once you believe. Yes, God may discipline us. We may feel his conviction when we're living ways that we shouldn't be living. But if you come to Christ, then what? You're going to come to the light. You want your deeds clearly seen because you want to be doing the will of God. Search my heart, O Lord. Try me. See if there is any wicked way within me. You see, that's what Jesus is talking about here in verse 21. That's the prayer of the believer in Jesus Christ, isn't it? Lord, I want to know your will. I'm in a situation today, Lord. I got to have a serious conversation with somebody, but I want it to be a godly conversation. I want you to tell me what I have to say and the right way to say it, you know, not too soft, not too hard. You know, I need you to show me the way. That's what I want. We're coming to the light. I want the deeds clearly seen because I want them done in you, Lord. I want them done in God. Search me, try me, Lord, show me. And I, you know, want to clean up whatever dirt's there. I want that searchlight on me. I want to see the things that I missed when I was sweeping or when I was cleaning. Oh, wow, look at that. You ever done that when you were cleaning? You think you got it? He's like, how did I miss that big patch over there, you know? And see, when we allow God to be that searchlight, there are some things that we might look at and say, oh, all right, it looks pretty clean. And then God says, wait, you see that? You see that? You see that? Because I sure do. But if we want to please God, it's not something to fear. It's not something to be terrorized about. Oh, no, God, does that mean I'm going to hell? I'm sorry. You know, no. I want you to clean it up. Just clean it up. And the beautiful thing is, although it's not necessarily taught in the passage, but it's taught elsewhere in the Bible, is not only will he show you, but he'll empower you to do it, right? There's nothing worse than trying to do a project, especially a cleaning project, and have the wrong stuff or the wrong tool or whatever, right? When God wants you to clean something up, he'll give you what you need to do the job right. And we can count on him. This is so crucial. This is the message of the Bible in very short verses. Now, there's a lot more, obviously, we could talk about, but how absolutely fundamental it is. And isn't it fascinating, as I said in the opening, and we're going to close right now, we don't see Nicodemus responding to any of this. He just, that's it. Bible just moves on. But we're going to see Nicodemus a couple more times. In a few chapters, when the religious leaders are really starting to get upset with Jesus and we've had enough of this guy or whatever, we're going to see Nicodemus. And you kind of can see that he's not fully on board necessarily with the man from Nazareth. But he kind of asks that question. He throws out there, does our law, you know, judge a man before he's had a chance to actually hear him out? And you see he's kind of on Jesus' side there a little bit, at least it may be in a semi-neutral way. But like, come on now, guys, wait a minute now. We're not acting right. I mean, shouldn't we listen to him at least a little bit? And then he's like, what are you defending the guy for? Are you on his side? You know, and they get all upset at that, even though he didn't really say that much. But even more significantly, after Jesus is crucified, after they get their will and they put him to death, he is not ashamed to be right there and say, I am going to be a part, along with this other guy, Joseph of Arimathea, says, and we are going to arrange a proper burial for this one. And I'm going to invest my own money and do the proper, you know, the aloes and all the things that the Bible says that he did. We'll get to that eventually when the time comes. But to be associated with someone who had been crucified, that's crazy talk. I mean, that's just because only the worst sort of prisoners were crucified. You want to say, not only am I friends with this person, but what we say is, I worship that person. That's my God. You can have Zeus and Jupiter and Neptune and, you know, Diana, and give me Jesus. And that's where we see Nicodemus. And we have to assume this conversation right here really laid that groundwork. Nicodemus knew, I'm not talking to some crazy religious zealot guy or someone who doesn't honor the true and living God. Or like, no, I need to learn from him. I have little doubt that we will see Nicodemus in heaven. In other words, we will see Nicodemus in heaven. I have no doubt. So let's pray. Our Lord, we thank you again for this time in your word. How wonderful it is to meditate upon the beautiful truths that are found, like the fact that there is no condemnation to those of us in Christ. Period. Just beautiful, Lord. That you do love us. And no matter what our earthly situation might be, what our bank account, our health, our relationships, our friendships, that your love stands and it is unquestioned. And we thank you for that. We're never alone in this world, ever. And Lord, that you also have a timing and that we have to have that patience. We have to seek you and look for you, hear your voice. So bless us as we go forth now. Bless your people, I pray. Help us, Lord, to embrace these truths and help us to, again, be witnesses to those in the world around us who just don't want to come to the light. Help us to speak the truth in love. Because even, Lord, we know some of those professing agnostics and atheists out there one day will come to the light as well. Help us to plant those seeds, to share the truth of the Word of God. And no better place could we share than these verses that we studied tonight. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.